Okay.
So.
Ciao, sì, credo di sì. Allora, buongiorno. Credo di parlare in inglese perché i termini tecnici così in italiano ancora non vengono più in spagnolo che in italiano. Credo si capirà lo stesso, però vabbè. Ok, I'm going to talk about some preliminary studies I am doing at Tenerife. Most of the things are very preliminary things and have been done as part of thesis, well, master thesis of some students under my direction, but yeah, nothing finished and nothing published yet. So, and probably, well, Massimo, Claudia, they will know much more than me about what I'm going to talk, but okay. okay, so the beginning, I will do a short introduction about AGN. I was asked to do that. So the active galactic nuclei are usually found in galaxies which produce very, very high luminosity in a very concentrated volume near the center. So now, with the telescope we have, with the facilities we have, we can more or less go and resolve what is inside. Before, I mean, about 20 years ago, it was very difficult to find what was inside. And the resolution was limited to seeing limited studies. So the knowledge has increased tremendously in the last 20 years. But the ways that the AGNs are known from more than 50 years. They were discovered as quasar. Later we have realized that many different types of active objects belong to the same classes, more or less, and there are some differences which are can be explained as part of the different parameters. Well, the interest of the AGNs is that they are like laboratories of strange physics. The such high luminosity cannot be explained by a stellar process, so they are not attributed in the center of the in AGN, in the nuclei. There are no well, there can be stars, but what is producing the luminosity is believed to be an accreting black hole with a lot of matter surrounding and with many processes going on. The AGNs have been like the poor brother in the family of galaxies, and but now in about 10 years ago, something like that, the interest for AGN has reverted because they have first a lot of importance in the cosmological studies. If you want to look further, you need to look at AGNs. I mean, most objects you will find at very high redshift in the redshift universe are quasars. And also, it's believed now that the quasar play an important, very important role in the galaxy formation, in the galaxy evolution, in the form of feedback. They may suppress the formation of stars. So, if you look at the luminosity function of the galaxies, you cannot explain the shape without taking into account the interaction with the possible quasar, which somehow stop the star formation in a galaxy. Okay. So the basic or the most accepted standard model for an AGN is something like this. This is, I mean, no one has seen something like this, but we can imagine it can be like this. And what is inside is here, split here in component. At the center, very center, there should be the black hole with a mass over 10 to the 6 solar masses. Surrounding the black hole, there should be an accretion disk, which is formed by very hot gas, about something like 100,000 Kelvin. And still surrounding this accretion disk, you may find gas clouds, which emit a lot of lines with different line width, with different speed. And still, surrounding this, you may find a dusty molecular torus, which emit which well, there is a lot of discussion about this this torus. In the last year, people think that it's not a sort of homogeneous structure, but a sort of clumpy structure. Some people related these clumps with the clouds which are emitting the part of the lines. And another interesting aspect of AGN is that they have a good distribution of the light over the whole electromagnetic spectrum. You can see emission from the radio until gamma rays. Obviously, different components of the AGN contribute to the different regions. The accretion disk, the corona, contribute what is called big blue bump, which is in the blue part and the optical blue and also the ultraviolet, also in the X-ray, soft X-ray, hard X-ray, and the high velocity gas contribute to the broad and narrow emission line. The dusty torus produce most of the radiation in the infrared. And what is more interesting for us is the jet, which produce radiation from the in the radio, and probably in the gamma rays. Well, in the gamma rays, and probably we can have also some extension to the optical part. Okay, so just putting together all different kind of AGNs, there have been some trials or some attempts to propose modified models, and they succeed more or less in explaining all the different types of AGNs. The parameters which are used commonly to classify the AGNs are the radio loudness. There are two classes of AGNs: those called radio quiet and those called radio loud. And that is also a very easy thing to classify the AGNs, which are the emission lines. The emission lines, you can find two types, broad lines and narrow lines. In general, the broad lines are the permitted lines, the narrow band are the forbidden lines, and also the permitted line has a narrow band component. And also, there are some AGNs which do not emit any emission lines. And those are called BLAC. BLAC is the prototype of this no lines spectrum. And also, there is another parameter which comes from the more physical modeling or more empirical modeling, which is the angle to a line of sight. This parameter has an increasing importance in the last time, because the dusty torus we were mentioning before seems to be the important ingredient to have type 1 or type 2. Type 2 are those AGNs which contains only narrow emission lines, and type 1 are the broad lines, the ones which contains also broad lines. So depending where you are looking to the edge on torus or face on torus, you will have type 1 or type 2 AGNs. In the case of BLAC, what dominates the emission is the jet. So the orientation of the jet relative to the line of sight is very critical. In the case that the jet is pointing toward us, we have a very interesting effect due to the velocity which the fluid is moving. The particle motion along the jet are are relativistic, so all relativistic effect from this radiation will have some relevance. Basically, two facts. One is the Doppler boosting of the flux. So when the jet is pointing toward us, we will have an increase of the flux, and when it's pointing far from us, we will have the sort of diminishing of the flux. And also the variability time scales varies depending if you are looking in this direction or if you are looking in the other, from the other direction. Okay? So about the jet itself, the jet is thought to be a fluid of high speed particle with some magnetic fields, and the high velocity particle with magnetic field produces synchrotron radiation. The flow is not expected to be completely homogeneous, so there may be some inhomogeneity which produce shock fronts. The shock front emission could reach until optical wavelength, and this is what the part of the emission which we see from blazers. Well, I forgot to say that the blazer is a term composed of two type of objects. One is the BLAC, the other is the first part, and the other comes from quasar, which are the quasar are what is called well, quasar is something which contains emission lines in principle, and flat spectrum radio quasar are those which in the radio they show a flat spectrum. So both seems to have the same property, which is the jet is pointing very close to the line of sight. So all this relativistic effect may take place there. Okay, so, well, there is also a model I put here because it's proposed by Massimo and Claudia, this sort of snaking model, which depending on the place where you can put an homogeneity here, you will have different Doppler boosting, Doppler factor. Okay, so in order to, here is a, also a model in which a sketch of the model, in which you can see where the radiation, the different wavelength come from, the jet. And well, this is a model and should be tested against observation. For that, we need a lot of observation, multi-frequency observation, in order to disentangle what is the relevant physical mechanism. So, after the launch of Fermi satellite, which is a gamma ray observatory, there have been a lot of activity setting follow-up programs or monitoring programs of a sample of objects which are seen by the satellite. In particular, I select a few of them. There are many, many. But well, here at Torino, you have the gas web. There is also a very important support program by the at the Boston University, and also Stewart Observatory Support Program, which is the one I'm using most now. Well. And the reason why I became interested in web or in Blazer is because at IAC we have many facilities, many optical telescope, small size telescope, which can be used for this type of support programs. They are not very demanded, so now people prefer to go to BLT, GTC, William Herschel, all these big telescopes. So we have a lot of time there. And well, just to mention that the IAC, because we manage the observatories in Isaña and El Roque Los Muchachos, we have international agreement with all institutions which want to put a telescope there. And up to now, most of the agreements consider that a Spanish astronomer should have 20% of the observing time. Well, we have also our own telescope, which we have 100% of the time. So, among the facilities we are using for follow-up of Blazer is the 80 centimeter telescope, optical, well, we have optical facilities and infrared facilities. For the optical, we have the 80-centimeter telescope. We have also robotic facilities. Stella telescope is from Potsdam, Las Cumbres, which has placed two small telescopes, 40 centimeters, and they are fully robotic, so you don't have to worry about when observation will be done or to be there, but just put the schedule and it will be done. And the TCS, which is for the infrared, we have the TCS, which is a 1.5 telescope, which is equipped with a very old camera. Well, we are fighting against the direction in order to have a new camera, but it doesn't seem to be which is going to work in the future. Well, there at IAC, we are a very small group. It's me, part of the time, and Pepa Becerra, which is working for MAGIC and is also interested in Blazer. She is doing much more science than me in this part. Well, now she is working for CTA, so she has to dedicate part of the time for that. And we have some people helping with the observation. We have a senior astronomer who is interested in having observation, even if he is not a field of research. And we have many PhD students which are getting interested because they want to start doing observation, to know, for instance, how to observe in the infrared. And the telescope operator, they also want to contribute to this observation, so they do observation when the telescope is free. Well, this is all the team we have there. Now I go to a different facility. What I'm using for this talk are data based on the spectropolarimetry, which is taken by the this person, Paul Smith, using these two telescopes. He has a spectropolarimetry with moderate resolution. It's working in the optical part. Most of the initial analysis of this data was done by a student of mine, which is Noel Castro. And he did this piece of work for the end of physics degree thesis. Well, here is the data I'm going to show, I've been using. You can see the different targets. There are about 30 targets, and these are the dates when it has been observed. Data started to be taken around end of 2008, and we have compiled data until the end of 2016. Well, in total, there are over 60 targets and more than 8,000 observations. We have been using only 27 objects, and we have something like 6,000 observations. Well, the first thing we did was to look at the spectra. Well, the spectra contain, well, you have flux spectra, and also you have polarization spectra. So here in this representation, I'm plotting in the middle. This is a sort of median spectrum with the standard deviation around, and the green part is the minimum, and the red is the maximum. This is the range of variability above the median spectrum. This is the range of variability below the median spectrum. You can see that, for instance, this is BLAC. Well, don't look at this. This is telluric absorption. It's not corrected. But you can see that in the high state, in the medium state, there are no lines. When you go to the low state, you can see some lines appearing. I think this is H alpha. Then you have also the typical flat spectrum radio quasar. This is magnesium 2 line, and you can see the same. You can see that when you go very high, the emission lines tend to dilute, tend to disappear. When you go to a low state, the emission lines become prominent. Okay, so the first thing we did was to try a classification of the different objects to see if they coincide with the usual classification. And well, we found some discrepancy, but in general we found the same. But the message is that the classification is not a net classification, because sometimes the object appears like the VLAC appear like a flat spectrum radio quasar, and so on, and the other also can change. We have also some targets which are dominated by the stellar population. So the emission you see is basically the population, the stellar emission with the typical absorption lines. Okay, we did the same with the polarization. Here is again the medium spectrum. In red, I'm plotting the polarized flux. You can see that in most cases the polarized flux is flat, so no features. This is what you expected, except in some cases we see some broad emission lines. We are not sure that this is real or is an effect, but at least it's very interesting to detect this. Well, for people who work in AGMs, the origin of the unified model comes from the detection of broad emission lines in polarized light in NGC 1068 about 30 years ago, something like that. Okay, so this is the first thing we... Okay, so then we try to do some more quantitative exercise with the spectra, and we found that there is a very nice match between the two Sloan filter G and R. This is the spectral range covered by the spectra, so we can produce synthetic photometry in two bands, so look for colors. And this is what we did. We did the typical analysis of looking how change the color when the source get brighter or dimmer. And we found the typical thing that in some cases they become bluer when brighter, and also some cases when they become redder when brighter. It usually is associated redder when brighter with flat spectrum radio quasar, and the bluer when brighter with the VLAC. We found also some cases in which the two trends appears. There is a sort of limiting magnitude, or I think it was called saturation magnitude. This was published by Massimo and Claudia many years ago. They found in, I don't remember the object, but we found in many objects, well, not many, but quite a few. We found this behavior. If you wait for a long time, I mean, in this case, for instance, if you have the chance to go very faint, at some point it looked like this trend, redder when brighter, appears here. And the same happened with this. If you go to very bright, sometimes you see again this trend. So it looks like a sort of universal behavior. In some cases, there are some branches. I mean, there is not clear a uniform trend, but there are some dispersion. Okay, so later we went, since we have a lot of data, so the natural trend is go to statistical tools and try to see, to do something at least with the data. The first thing was to, well, we tried. The main goal is try to characterize the variability in this range, see time scales, periodicities, or whatever, which can explain the different physical mechanism. We adopt two different approaches. The first thing is look for variability time scales. For this, we apply two tools. One is the discrete correlation function, and the second one is the structure function, and we also adopt an approach different, which is search for variability patterns. So since we have the color, so we can see if the variability is associated with the change of colors. And for this, we apply the principal component analysis. Okay, so now I'm going to the details of the different things. And the first thing is the discrete correlation function. The correlation function, as you may know, what measures is how similar are two functions. If you have two different functions, whatever, you simply move one with respect to the other at different position, and you compute the correlation. And this is what is called correlation function. It's very simple defined. When you have a continuous function, when you have discrete function, the problem is different. You have to adopt some strategy to derive the discrete the correlation function. What is commonly used in blazars is a discrete correlation function, which was proposed by Krolik and Edelson, and later by Hufnagel and Bremann. They measure how different are the two light curves. The mathematical expression is this: you compute the function at any delay, just taking the average between the different values of the function with respect to the mean, or the deviation of the function with respect to the mean. Once you have the appropriate time delay. Okay, so what is the advantage? Well, this has been proposed because at the very beginning, what people was doing was interpolating the data. When you don't have data, so you create an interpolation, and you do the correlation function with the interpolated data. The advantage of this is that you can apply to any type of data, which are not evenly sampled. If you use the same function, instead of having two different functions, you have the same function, you apply this, is called autocorrelation function. And, well, some properties. If you do the autocorrelation function of a periodic series, the maximum corresponds to the period and to the multiple of the period. So, for instance, if you have a sinus, you will have a sinus. If you have a periodic pulse, you have a periodic pulse as an autocorrelation function. The problem is the significance of the result when you are doing this type of exercise. So, instead of using the common discrete correlation function, I use what is called set-transform discrete correlation function, which was proposed by Alexander in 2013. And he proposed this as a more robust method to compute the DCF. The main difference is that when you are doing the binning of the data, you don't use equally spaced time interval, but you use equally sampled time intervals. And the correlation is not estimated by the correlation factor, which is called R commonly, but by the set transform, which has this expression. Okay, so I did this exercise to all the data, and I found this type of behavior. So what do you learn from the correlation function? First, you can look, well, this is the light curve of two objects. They look very differently. This one look like a long-lasting variability behavior, and this one has a lot of flickering. Okay, so if you look at the autocorrelation function, what you see is that in this case, the slope, well, this is one and this is zero. The slope here is much less steeper than in this case. So the slope of the correlation function before reaching the zero, the first time you reach zero, indicates the sort of typical variability time scale, the duration the duration of the flaring. So if you have a very broad flare and you move, you will have still correlation after several days. If you have very peaky flares, after one day you will lose the correlation. Okay, so this is what is indicated here. So it can be used, this slope can be used as a measurement or an objective measurement of the variability time scales. What else? Well, we have some, well, we have different shape of the autocorrelation function, but something which is very interesting for me, at least, is that in some case you see this type of sinusoidal behavior. As I said before, if you have a sinusoidal time series, the autocorrelation function will be again a sinusoidal function. So in this case, if you check the distance between peak and the distance between valleys, you can see also that the correlation factor here is the same in positive and in negative, so it looks like what you expect for a periodic sinusoidal series. And we found the same for different cases. Depending on the target, is much clearer or less clear. Okay, so the period is about, in this case, is about 850 days, and in this case, is about 700 days. The time we have been sampling is about 3,000 days, so we are not very comfortable in detecting this time, this period, if we have such short time sampling. But nevertheless, the signal seems to be significant, and this is what we have up to now. Well, in other cases, what you can see is that the correlation goes to zero after this initial decay. The correlation goes to zero, and then there appear some peaks. This is the case of BLAC. We have a peak which is about 1,300 days, and the same here, which is about 2,000 days for another target. It looks like we have a sort of recurrence period, which for me, at least, it's not clear to see from the light curve, but in the correlation function, it appears with a high significance, relatively high significance, it's about 0.5, and with a small error bar. And the big question is, but our blazes are really periodic, and there has been some, well, we are finding sort of periodic behavior in few cases. And some other people have also claimed that they found periodicity in their data. And there are some works by Sandrinelli et al. And also Graham et al. In this case, they did the analysis based on the Fourier analysis, Fourier techniques, which is much more difficult because working in the Fourier space with the uneven sample data is very, very difficult. And well, some caveats about the periodicity claims is that the period we are finding is relatively large compared with the baseline we have, so we need much longer baseline. And according to this paper, the stochastic variation can mimic the periodic oscillation. So even if we see clear signs of periodic variation, there seems to be a result of stochastic variation. The other thing is the other tool we use is the structure function. The structure function, what measure is a sort of variance of the flux density as a function of the separation in sampling interval. Well, just to say that it's commonly used to describe the phase variation in atmospheric optics, which is used to model the adaptive optics behavior. It's called the Kolmogorov spectrum. It's not so commonly used in blazer studies, but I think it's also an interesting tool. In the case of periodic time series, what there will be is a minimum instead of a maximum when you have the period. So if you see a minimum in this function, well, repeated minimum, it indicates that you have a sort of periodic time series. There is a relationship between the structure function and the Fourier power spectrum. If the Extractor function is a power law. The power spectrum is also a power law with this index. Okay, so if you have an increasing extractor function, you will have a decreasing power law in the power spectrum in terms of frequency. Okay, so what is commonly thought to be the pattern of variability in quasar is what is called damped random walk model, and this comes from the variability observed in blazar. People propose that this is red noise, which is a random process with the brought down spectrum, which decrease towards low frequency as a power law. Well, this is the reference of this model, and they have a good, well analytical shape for the autocorrelation function, and they have also analytical shape for the power spectral density. Using this information, you can see that the relationship between the extractor function and the power spectral density, you will find that if this model is the explanation of the variability, the extractor function should behave as linear with time. Well, there is what is called bend frequency, in which you see this behavior. So the power spectral density should look like a constant at low frequency, and then when you go to high frequencies, it will decrease following this power law. Well, so this is what we are finding with our data. What I plot here is what you expect if you have a damped random walk model. And you see that at least in few cases, at least in these cases, it worked like this model. There is another case different here. Also the same, you can see that in many cases, at the beginning of the spectral function, extractor function, you see the same behavior, and then there is a sort of flattening of the extractor function. Here is when you consider that the variability has finished. So all processes which are within this time interval are sort of correlated. When you are beyond this time interval, processes are not correlated. Okay, so the third tool we were using is the principal component analysis. The principal component analysis is a mathematical tool which is used in multivariate analysis, and is able to, if you have a sort of set of measurement with some dispersion, you can see here, for instance, that they look like oriented in this direction, and the principal component analysis is able to identify this privileged direction of variation, and this is what you can find here in this graph. You see like when you apply the principal component analysis, it will identify two different axes which are orthogonal, and you can explain the whole variation of this in this new frame. Okay, so basically what is doing the principal components analysis is to find the eigenvector, eigenvalues of the covariance matrix. Well, if you have a lot of variables, it has to be done by using the singular value decomposition. Otherwise, it can be done with normal or less sophisticated tools. And principal component analysis is very useful if you want to reduce the dimensionality of a problem. If you have many variables, many parameters from a phenomenon, and you want to say what is the minimum number of parameters I need to put into my model to reproduce this behavior, you can use principal component analysis, and it will tell you sort of minimum vectors you need to model the observed variation. Okay, so what I did was I select again the data from the Stuart Observatory. I select the synthetic photometry and the polarization degree. I include also the near infrared photometry from our data taken at Teide, and I use also the ultraviolet photometry taken from UBOT. In total, this get 10 parameters, not so much, but the main difficulty here is to find simultaneous data in all bands. And I say I stress valid data because in some cases we don't have good measurements, so you have to filter out the data before going to the analysis. The next step I'm planning to do is to include radio and high energy data. But again, the main difficulty will be to find the simultaneous data. Okay, so these are the preliminary results. You can see this case is the optical plus infrared light curve. In red are the, sorry for the small symbols. In red is the infrared, green is the G filter, and this is the UBOT data. After you do the principal component analysis, what you find is that with two components, you can explain most of the variance. If you add another component, the third component, you can have the 98% of the variance of the data. You cannot read the data, but this is about 80%, and this is about 20%. So with only two components, you can almost explain the 100% of the variance. Just formally, if you want to be at 98%, you need to include the third component. Okay. So what do you see in the vectors? So in the eigenvectors look like the first component contain the about one third in the components which are related to brightness, to magnitude. 10% is related to polarization. The second component, which is this 20%, contains 10% in optical magnitude, 5% in infrared magnitude, 1% in ultraviolet magnitude, and about 70% in a polarization degree. Okay, so here we can identify this as the component of the brightness. This is the component of the polarization, which look like decoupled. And the third component is a sort of mix, right? The interesting thing is that they have about 20-30% infrared and ultraviolet, which are not correlated. They look like anti-correlated. So in this case, the vector is pointing, this is increasing magnitude. Well, here I'm plotting the scatter plot, sorry to not explain before. So in this case, I'm plotting magnitude polarization. This is a scatter plot of magnitude polarization. This is a scatter plot of magnitude versus magnitude. So here you can see that there is a direction, privileged direction. When you increase the magnitude in any band, it will increase in the other band. And here the polarization doesn't show this behavior. In polarization, you see a vector which is aligned with the brightness and another vector which is aligned, another vector which is aligned with the polarization axis. I did also the same exercise for Markarian 421, and again two components are enough to explain the 10 parameters, and it looks slightly different. Well, the first component contains again brightness with some increase relevance of the polarization, and the second component contains also the polarization degree. Well, the next step is to apply the same to the spectra. In the case of a spectra, we have much more data. We have also information from the lines. This is the first attempt I was doing with a similar technique to PCA. And here, in this case, I analyze one of the blazer which is contaminated by the stellar light, and you can see that with this simple two component, you have a component which is the stellar contribution plus a sort of futureless component which come from the jet. This component varies, and these components tend to be stable. Okay, so I finish here. Thanks to the organizer for the invitation. Thanks to Claudia and Maribel for hosting me here. So that's all. Question, pregunta, demande. Sí, va bene. Sì, è più difficile, non so se trova cose in più, cioè trovi un po' la conferma di quello che stai trovando con questo tipo di analisi. In più c'hai la complessità di fare tutti i controlli, di vedere gli armonici, queste cose qua. Io non sono esperto per niente in fare queste cose. Ho parlato con qualcuno lì all'IAC che fa queste cose per il Sole. Lui ha fatto circa 5-6 pagine per trovare quello che avevo trovato io con questa DCF. No, e lui è più sicuro, sì. Ci sono anche altre tecniche tipo wavelet e queste cose qua che sembrano che funzionano un po' meno, cioè sono più critiche che quel che fare Fourier analysis. Spariscono. Non so, io ho una idea un po' naif, cioè, in questo senso che non credo che siano due buchi neri che tornano, ma girano attorno di sé, ma mi sembra più una cosa relazionata con il getto, cioè il getto deve avere una struttura tipo, non so, elicoidale, così, che gira così, eppure anche può precessare, no? Questo ti può far vedere, cioè tu hai un shock front da qualsiasi parte e questo devi muoversi e dipende di, non so, Doppler boosting, qualsiasi cosa che ti fa che ogni tanto, periodicamente, mentre questa struttura sia lì fissa, per esempio se guardi M87, quello lì c'ha il shock lì messo da circa, non so, di 40 anni che non si muove. È sempre lì, però se immagini uno di questi jet che fa un po' così, credo che si deve vedere tipo questo behavior sinusoidale.
Che si possono ricavare posizione dell'angolo di polarizzazione all'interno della plotline, cioè parte da puntino con un certo angolo, se vedi delle variazioni sulla plotline vuol dire che è un certo tipo di scheletro, eccetera. L'altra cosa è la larghezza delle righe, perché nel caso del third spectrum, se hai scheletri, ti aspetti che le righe polarizzate sono molto più larghe delle righe di luce diretta, una cosa che abbiamo visto recentemente, beh, sai benissimo perché ho fatto qualche pensiero su questo. No, questo vabbè, senza troppo nel tecnico, quindi mi fermo qui, però magari ne parliamo un attimo perché quei dati lì, soprattutto, veramente il singolo spettro non ha segnale rumore sufficiente per fare questa analisi dettagliata, però la plotline è abbastanza stabile, per cui si può pensare magari di mettere insieme tutti gli spettri dello stesso spettro.
Sì, quello che ho mostrato io è fatto così. C'è
Ok, sì.
il tipo.
Ok, poi ne parliamo dopo perché sennò qualcosa magari lo perdo.
Sì, sicuramente.
Esempio, quella, soprattutto le parti sulla polarizzazione che immagino saranno le misure più con errore più grosso. Tipicamente è così, no? Le misure di polarizzazione sono complicate. Quindi qui c'è un discorso di come gioca l'errore random delle misure che tu hai ad affrontare. State pensando di introdurre questo aspetto, cioè quando si parla di periodogrammi, a cui facevo accenno, una cosa tipica è non soltanto, ma cominci a parlare di probabilità di fault detection, no? Cioè dove sta la tua sicurezza in quello che vedi, no?
Sì.
Ecco, è un aspetto che stai affrontando, lì devi dedurre, no, tutta una serie di considerazioni scientifiche che sono drammaticamente importanti, su dove queste variabilità, se ci sono periodicità, se ci sono, dove stanno.
Sì, cioè, un conto è quella parte prima di fare la variabilità, cercare i periodi, queste cose qua. Un'altra cosa è questo, un po' diverso.
Qui tu stai caratterizzando il tuo segnale, la tua
Le componenti.
sì, del tuo segnale che non è stabile, no? Cioè,
Sì.
a parte che sia periodico o no, c'è questa variabilità
Sì,
effettivamente.
sì, sì. Cioè, beh, qua c'è un piccolo problemino, perché la stimazione dell'errore, cioè, noi non abbiamo degli spettri di Paul Smith, non abbiamo una stimazione dell'errore. Sicuramente ci sarà l'errore assoluto e sistematico di su e giù della calibrazione. In più ci sarà l'errore dello spettro, no? Però come facciamo fotometria sintetica, cioè prendiamo tutto il flusso su una banda, sicuramente l'errore non sia tanto grande e sia comparabile a quello della fotometria. Però a volte bisogna scartare punti, queste cose qua. Questo, come avevo de detto prima, l'ha fatto uno studente. Lui non è riuscito a darmi un valore significativo dell'errore.
È una parte complessa, mi
Sì. E in più, calcolare l'errore della polarizzazione è più complesso ancora.
credo che sia una cosa su cui
Sì, io voglio farlo, però no, devo fare prima, cioè prima devo trovare il tempo di mettermi a fare i conti, poi a controllare quello che ha fatto lui.
l'ultimo commento è quando si mettono insieme, questa è una cosa che forse avrei dovuto dire neanche io, quando si mette insieme. Si mettono insieme dati in multifrequenza. Quanto è critica questo parametro della simultaneità? Cioè, simultaneo vuol dire proprio contemporanei dal punto di vista dell'analisi, non voglio adesso, è chiaro che sono delle difficoltà, no? Per farle esatte, perché simultaneo vuol dire senza.
Beh, dipende dall'oggetto, perché per esempio adesso noi che stiamo guardando questo oggetto 0836, non so, tranquillo, cioè c'è i suoi tempi, sembra un... Invece sono altri molto nervosi, allora cioè, dipende dall'oggetto. Dalla frequenza anche, no? Ecco. Sì. Sì. Beh, io sono stato più rilassato qua, ho messo 2 giorni un po'. Ecco. Ah. Sì, poi cioè, non ha senso neanche stare a guardare quando hai un puntino 2 volte al mese, invece stare lì a vedere se fra la stessa ora, no? È un po'. Soprattutto per fare queste cose qua, che ci sono 100 punti, 200 punti. Cioè, se ti metti così, cioè, con metti constraint molto forti, fai la statistica con 2 punti. Sì. Anche perché cioè, il pattern delle osservazioni di questo database è un po'. Cioè, se vedete qua, assomiglia a uno di questi bar code, no? Cioè, ci sono dei periodi in cui osserva molto, poi ci sta, vanno in vacanza. Sì,
Quindi c'è un tot e quindi.
sì. No, fa benissimo. Sì. Sì, no, noi abbiamo scoperto che per questo periodo qua, non mi ricordo, c'era un periodo in cui sembrava che lui prendeva le vacanze, perché no, Questi sono quelli, gli spettri presi al tuo osservatorio, sì. No, se io faccio lo stesso con i nostri dati è molto irregolare, perché noi, cioè, a questo telescopio dobbiamo litigare con altre persone per avere il tempo, così non è sicuro. Te volevo fare una domanda? Ah. Sì.
Spunta questo picco. E ti voglio chiedere se hai se hai un criterio, una falsa probability con cui puoi discriminare picchi spuri, oppure no, oppure proprio non lo puoi sapere.
Ma questo bisogna fare tutta l'analisi di significatività, queste cose qua. E se non hai l'errore della tua misura è un po' difficile da fare prima. Sì. Sì,
Anche se non lo sai, qualcosa di sensato, poi lo metti come parametro.
sì. Sì, però sì. Abbiamo cercato di fare anche questo, però.
E invece la seconda era se questi studi di appunto periodicità delle variabilità, oppure quello dimostrato, per cui cerchi di capire quali sono le componenti che danno luogo alla variabilità, poi cercate di correlarli con qualche parametro, non so quale, per capire cosa ti dicono di più appunto sulla fisica delle APM o sugli oggetti, cioè se
una volta che avete un campione statistico significativo, che tipo di correlazioni puoi fare per capire qualcosa in più? Cosa sta succedendo dal punto di vista statistico?
Uff, cioè quello sarebbe l'ultimo goal, diciamo, cioè, però bisogna lavorare con qualcuno che conosce i modelli, queste cose qua, non lo so.
Posso fare un commento? Allora, il problema di questi oggetti qua è che tu vedi appunto tante componenti, no? Noi, quella predominante in generale, quasi tutte le frequenze d'onda, è quella del getto, proprio perché cioè, questo oggetto mi dispara proprio addosso, no? E quindi viene boostato, la radiazione viene boostata e quindi domina. Però alle volte la gente si dimentica che soprattutto nel primo oggetto ci sono delle altre componenti, cioè la galassia per gli oggetti vicini e questo bump, il blue bump, che è la componente di disco del tutto del crescimento. Se tu ti dimentichi di quello, ti capitano delle cose strane. Per esempio, se studi la polarizzazione e la correlazione che c'è tra la polarizzazione e il flusso, puoi erroneamente interpretare alle volte che quando la sorgente è in flare aumenta la polarizzazione, no? Perché è quello che vedi. Se però ti ricordi che sotto c'è un disco, una componente termica non polarizzata, e trascuri che questa componente diluisce il flusso del getto, allora trovi questa correlazione, questa polarizzazione e flusso, che è erronea. Se tu correggi per la presenza di questa componente stabile, ti accorgi che questa correlazione non c'è più. Semplicemente, quando l'oggetto è stato basso, praticamente la polarizzazione dell'oggetto viene diluita dalla componente non polarizzata e quindi si abbassa la polarizzazione. Quando invece l'oggetto va in flare, la componente di getto predomina e non si accorge e la diluizione non fa niente. Quindi tu guardi una curva osservativa, vedi si alza il flusso, si alza la polarizzazione, dici, oh guarda, la polarizzazione non era più in flusso. Se corregge invece per questo componente di disco, la polarizzazione, dallo stato basso va allo stato alto e dici, oh cavolo, non c'è più correlazione. Questo per dire come è molto complicato ma molto importante separare le varie componenti per capire che razza di... cioè cosa stai guardando? Stai guardando il getto? Stai guardando il punto centrale che...
guarda quella figura che quella, la parte in alto a destra è la polarizzazione, no? Se mi ricordo bene, giusto?
Questa qua. No, questo sarebbe... Sì, questo è gli stessi dati questi, ma standardizzati.
Quindi lì, perciò facevo la domanda sull'errore. Mentre la magnitudine correla molto bene, sì che si vede, la pinza si dice, il fatto che sopra non correli può essere però adesso due cose. O c'è troppo rumore, quindi lì non c'è nessuna interpretazione fisica. Oppure è quello che stai dicendo te. Capito? Ora, escludere che questo è un rimescolamento fisico e non... cioè la pinza va controllare anche una tecnica statistica, non ti dice niente della fisica, ti dice, guarda, non posso spiegarla con rumore, quindi deve essere associata a qualcosa. E l'altro suggerimento che ti dice, ma questi modelli adesso anche nella nostra galassia, cioè sto motore centrale, forse è il caso che consideri tutta una serie di periodicità, perciò è complicato. Hai visto che tutte queste stelle vicine, no? Questa immagine del primo passo. No, scusami, dei primi alcune decine di parsec, dove c'è tutta l'azione, stelle che stanno andando ad accrescere, eccetera, e lì ci sono tutta una serie di periodicità. Quindi hai una multiple periodicity, perciò che si trasforma in flickering, diciamo così. Piuttosto che una sola periodicità, forse conviene cominciare a cercare multi periodicità. Non so che si complica il tempo.
Quindi
l'SST potrebbe essere interessante, se tu nel tempo, perché tu hai bisogno di cadenzare con dati estremamente precisi, e quindi discutere con questa. Secondo me sulla parte in alto a destra c'è una possibile scoperta, cioè dite, cioè questo non è rumore, perché non posso spiegare, altrimenti mi dici, ma è rumore o no? Questa è la risposta che deve dare chi fa l'analisi statistica in questo caso.
Però volevo sottolineare, separare probabilistica non mi intende, quindi questi lavori qua sono estremamente importanti.
Ti dice cosa cercare, come spiegare, cioè.
Nei pannelli centrali è montino e contro montino in due bandi diversi.
I colorini sono diversi, sì. E i verdi sono il G, sì. Sì, questo sarebbe G versus U-Bot, una delle bande più ultraviolette. Questo sarebbe R, mi sembra, su H. Cioè il rosso sarebbe più verso l'infra... Come? Sì, quelli che, cioè, questo è quello che mi dice la componente. Cioè, tu alla fine quello che hai è un vettore. E ogni vettore ha una quantità fisica, diciamo, che un parametro fisico che tu hai misurato. E quelli che sono, che vengono dalle magnitudini hanno 33%. Sono praticamente uguali tutti. Cioè il vettore, se prendi due magnitudini sarebbe sulla riga 1-1. Cioè, si può vedere un pochino che cambiano un pochino, però in generale è così. Però è interessante, per esempio, quello che ho visto in questa qua, questa terza componente, non so se può essere un rumore o quello che sia, però ci sono, invece di andare insieme, sono anticorrelati. Sì, sì, sì.
Perché 70% non ci credo, per quanto rumore ci possa essere, ma quando vai a 5% alla terza componente...
Sì, 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 no, no, anche cioè, se vedi la terza componente, cioè spiega il 1% della varianza.
Sì.
Sì, soprattutto sono questi due componenti che spiegano quasi il 100%. Invece questa terza è così, siamo un po' più... Bene? Bene, grazie.